We realize that there's so much power in these large language models. How do we make it safe? How do we know we're safe? How do we know our jobs aren't being replaced? How do we know that these large language models just don't start thinking for us, take over the world?
This is Horizons, stories about what's next in the world, powered by Compass Data Centers.
My name is Arthur Soroken. I currently lead growth and community for Labs, Google's AI initiative. Artificial intelligence is a study of and a practice of trying to bring human-like intelligence to machines. When it comes to generative AI, it's about the using the same backbone of artificial intelligence, but how do we create and generate content, typically around using natural language processing, images, videos, et cetera, but it's around generating of content beyond just the learning and the reasoning. So how do we generate new content? If you look back, artificial intelligence has been talked about for quite some time. Since, you know, you could date back to probably the 1950s, Alan Turing was starting to talk about artificial intelligence and how do we create intelligent understanding of these systems. It's only in the last year that we put this in your pocket. You don't have to have a deep technical background to understand the inner workings. You don't have to care about the inner workings of artificial intelligence. It's the first time in history where artificial intelligence is literally an application on your desktop or in your pocket that you can engage with. Human, natural language, you can engage with this chat interface to do summarization, help you write content, help you create content, help you summarize content, help you solve problems that you weren't able to solve before. It's the first time in history that we put this technological thing in a accessible human form that anyone can engage with. You've seen exponential growth in technology and artificial intelligence, but to get to that next step, we actually have to solve some pretty critical problems. Number one, we have to solve the resourcing and computation problem. There's only a few companies in the world that have the capital to have these TPUs and GPUs and this capital to run these large language models. They're quite compute intensive. Number two, education. I think education is a huge area where this technology has happened so fast that our education system, our workplaces, et cetera, have not caught up. And so one of the things we need to start doing, or we should encourage our education systems to catch up, to start to teach how to use artificial intelligence in the workplace, in the education space, et cetera, so that we can get the knowledge up. When you get the knowledge up, you can actually have a very good conversation, and you can start to think about how do we think about the benefits of technology, and also how do we also think about the benefits of artificial intelligence, but also how do we have a good conversation about how to control some of the negatives. I think number three thing that needs to happen is the quality just needs to increase. You know, how many people use ChatGPT or any of these other developer tools, or generative AI developer tools, how many people are using them, but constantly have to coach it? And most people would probably tell you that this is actually something I have to look at quality control, and it's because the qualities do what they call hallucinate quite a bit. Is it a matter of time before the hallucinations go away? We perfect the models, we train the models, we fine-tune the models. Is it just a matter of time? I would actually say that this is a really hard technological problem to solve, and we haven't been able to solve it yet. And so I think there's a lot more advancements that need to happen in this field to increase the quality that humans feel comfortable with its standards. With all of this technology and the power of large language models at our fingertips, what does this mean for identity? What does this mean for humans? It definitely evolves identity a bit. I think we as humans spend a lot of time identifying with a thing we do every day, which is typically our jobs. And when it comes to the jobs, you have to think about the different aspects of the jobs, because large language models, they don't replace your jobs overnight. They can't replace the human aspect. They can't replace the human touch. They can't replace the human interaction. They can't do any of that. We still need humans to comfort us. What large language models can do is remove some of that the processes and the tools and that grungy stuff we do every day in our jobs. My hope is that we start to identify less with the spreadsheet and the inputting. We start to identify more with the reason we got into these careers or the creative side of the things we love to do, the things that large language models are not very good at. I also hope that it changes our identity to spend more time with our loved ones and our friends and our family as opposed to spending these long hours in doing the thing we actually don't love. We don't have to identify or go into one field of study. Individuals have more accessibility to technology and to use the power of technology to solve way more problems and to create way more opportunities. Large language models give users or give individuals tools to expand beyond what they currently identify, which is their job every day, or to expand beyond the field of study that they've spent so much time on, expand beyond the socioeconomic background that they come from. You don't have to be a trained developer to build software or websites or technological systems to solve problems. You don't have to be a startup founder or an entrepreneur that has to go raise money or that has to use their own money to start their ventures. With large language models, you can have a team in your pocket that can do a lot of these tasks that weren't possible before. Large language models give us human beings the ability to stretch into many different avenues that weren't possible before. I come from a very traditional background of engineering. I have a computer and electrical engineering degree. I worked in software tech for a long time. I dabbled and worked in machine learning. I dabbled in neural networks. I wasn't prepared for this evolution. I went from having to learn coding and best practices and theory and logic around computer science to a world where I can literally say, hey, chatbot, develop this thing for me. It almost feels non-engineering-like. And so now I have this co-pilot, this engineering co-pilot that's up-leveled me. So I would never consider myself in the past as an artificial intelligence expert. And I would think people who definitely don't have technological backgrounds or machine learning backgrounds would say, I'm an AI expert. But I actually think today, a lot of people can say, I understand how to shape an AI bot or to shape large language models to deliver the experience I want. And that is a powerful gift.